Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Distinguished speakers and panelists, conference participants, excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, let me first thank the Shanghai Forum Organizing Committee for inviting me to today's gathering. Over the years, Shanghai Forum has brought together many political dignitaries, distinguished scholars, and business leaders to share their thoughts and wisdoms. Indeed, I am honored to be given such an opportunity today. I am also delighted to be here in Shanghai. This is my first visit to Shanghai since completing my 10-year term as President of the Republic of Indonesia. Therefore, to all our Chinese friends here, I thank you for your friendship towards Indonesia. Let me begin by saying that the relations between Indonesia and China are solid, strong, and continuing to deepen and expand rapidly. In the past, our bilateral relationship may have experienced certain ups and downs. However, in 2005, during my first term in office, we entered a new chapter of relationship with the establishment of this strategic partnership. 8 years later, this partnership was elevated to a comprehensive strategic partnership. I trust that my successor, President Jokowi, will continue to strengthen the close cooperation between our two countries. The themes of today's forum, economic globalization and the choice of Asia, interconnectivity, integration and innovation, building a community of common destiny in Asia is very relevant and timely, particularly when considering that the Asian region has evolved into the axis on which economic globalization revolves. Therefore, through today's forum, let us deliberate on recent trends in Asia with a view to getting a better sense of the future of this region. Let us also discuss on how to further develop a community of common destiny in Asia by ensuring the region rise as the global engine for economic progress. Before we discuss our region, I would like to share my views on the global outlook. 2016 will be a challenging year for us all. The geopolitical world will continue to be volatile and fragile. Relations between the major powers will continue to be dynamic, resulting from a lack of strategic trust. And an overarching Asia-Pacific security architecture remains elusive. We hope, I should say, the forces of integration and disintegration will continue to battle. Fear and anxiety will compete with hope and opportunity. We therefore hope the result of elections in many Asian countries this year, Australia, the Philippines, Japan, and South Korea, would have strengthened regional cooperation and shared prosperity. Compared to last year, the world economy is expected to do better, but only slightly. For this year, the IMF projected a bleak outlook, lamenting that the world economy is moving too slow for too long. Recently, they revised the projection of the global economic growth from 3.4% to 3.2%. What is clear is that the new normal is here to stay for a while: low growth, low productivity, and high unemployment. And as noted in the World Economic Forum, inequality has reached a new threshold. More than half of all the wealth in the world is now owned by 1% of the population. This force is a headwind against our overall economic growth, thus rendering our current recovery effort unsustainable. The good news is that ASEAN economies are doing well relative to many others. The ASEAN 6 is expected to grow by 4.7%. CLMV countries, Cambodia, Laos, Myanmar, Vietnam are expected to achieve higher growth than ASEAN 6, with Myanmar topping that list. But don't forget, it is really hard to make predictions because there remain big unknowns ahead. Will China's economy recover rapidly and resume its previous strong growth? Who will win the US presidential elections in November this year? What will happen to Brexit? Will the current offensive against ISIS be successful? When and where will the next terrorist attack occur? And how will they attack? And as usual, there are always events that we never thought could happen, and then they erupt in a flash. We may not have the answers for these unknowns, but we must recognize that they pose extreme global challenges, and even more so in our region. To be sure, Asia has come a long way to be where we are today. I must admit that many things I see today are beyond my wildest imagination as a high school teenager or a young military officer. Back then, no one talked about Asian century. No one really thought that the strategic and economic weight of the world would shift to Asia. We were supposedly so far behind the West that it would take generations just to catch up. Yet, these are the signs of our times. In my view, there are several forces which continue to change the face of Asia for the better. The first is the phenomenal growth of the middle class. I believe we are on our way to transform a continent of poverty to a continent of wealth. And the middle class is right at the core of this historic process. The growth of the middle class is arguably the most revolutionary thing that can happen to a society. It is revolutionary in terms of its transformational effect to the physical, mental, economic, and political makeup of a society. When the middle class proliferates, you see its powerful impact in many forms: the rise of cities, economic growth, tax revenues, and others. The Asian Development Bank predicted that by 2050, there will be an additional 3 billion people joining the middle class in Asia. Imagine that 3 billion people. There is several times more than the combined populations of the United States, Canada, and Latin America. Moreover, this automatically means that the poor has been reduced by 3 billion. Closely connected to the rise of the middle class is the second force that I believe will sweep Asia: the rapid spread of entrepreneurship. I believe that there is a strong correlation between the number of entrepreneurs in a society and its degree of dynamism and progress. Entrepreneurship reflects confidence, independence, and risk-taking. It signals a shift in the state of mind of a society. It signals can-do-ism. It signals positive energy. It signals innovation. Indeed, promoting and developing innovation has become an important factor in encouraging societal progress. In China, President Xi Jinping has identified innovation as one of the 5 pillars to manage the new normal in China's economic development. In his view, innovation promotes more efficient and effective use of human resources. When I lived in Indonesia for a decade, I have always underlined the need for us to put ahead innovation and technology combined with entrepreneurship in laying the foundation for our future. By harnessing technological innovation and the spirit of entrepreneurship, we will enhance our capacity to develop resources, mainly natural resources, more efficiently and wisely. We could maintain economic growth, social inclusion, and environmental protection simultaneously. This is the fundamental concept of green growth and sustainable development that, as chairman of Global Green Growth Institute, GGGI, I strongly encourage to be pursued by all nations. This way, goods could be produced and services rendered better, cheaper, and faster. Industries are made more productive and competitive. When we observe at how the Chinese economy has grown, the evidence of entrepreneurism is markedly visible, not only in raising standards of life, but also in the increasing equality among the majority of the people. That is why I am convinced that the rapid contagion of entrepreneurism will be one of the most powerful game changers for Asian economies. The third force that will shape Asia's future is connectivity. In the 20th century, many nations were preoccupied with the issue of sovereignty. But in the 21st century, the game is more about connectivity. It is about how connected you are to the world economy, to the global marketplace of ideas, and to the infrastructures that connect the dots. I would not underestimate the power of connectedness. In my country, for centuries, the poor were weak, not just because they lacked economic means, but also because they were marginalized, isolated, and disconnected. They felt alone and therefore helpless, thus becoming fatalistic, accepting of their fate. Connectivity changes that. Today, a poor person will feel empowered if he or she feels connected to others. If a person has access to the internet, email, YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and other digital things, that person will somehow feel entitled, enabled, and even powerful. This is how young people in the Middle East, many of them poor and unemployed, brought down strong government during the Arab Spring. Connectivity in all its dimensions will transform individuals, economies, and regions, and will be a critical part of the evolution of Asian century. There are, of course, many more forces driving change in Asia, but I would pick this as my fourth, something that I spent promoting as President of Indonesia. Regionalism. There is already a lot of nationalism and plenty of national interest in the diplomatic arena. Yet, I believe peace would be assured if such nationalism is coupled with a healthy dose of regionalism. Regionalism does not always grow easily. Northeast Asia is still having a difficult time developing one. Regionalism has also been difficult to take root in South Asia. Even in Europe, there is a sensitive debate over how far should European regionalism expand without creating new strategic tension. Southeast Asian experience has been a lot better. ASEAN has peacefully expanded from 5 members to 6 and then to 10 members, covering all of Southeast Asia. In fact, ASEAN countries have all formally entered into an ASEAN community. Our ASEAN experience demonstrates that we can evolve both at national identity and regional identity at the same time. Regionalism has also delivered good dividends. ASEAN countries have become more secure, more united, and more prosperous because of it. We should welcome, therefore, the initiative of China in introducing the concept of one belt, one road, and establishment of Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. I believe that this effort will complement the existing ASEAN connectivity and the Asian Development Bank respectively, and enhancing regional economy. In the healthier regionalism can also be made to grow in another part of Asia, then the impact on Asia will be far-reaching. The Asian Central will have much better prospect. In this forum, I would like to share 3 points that enhance a strong regional cooperation to ensure a dynamic, peaceful, and prosperous Asia. First, we must continue to work together to reap our common future and share prosperity. I believe, despite our respective national interests, we all have an abiding interest in seeing stable, cooperative, and positive relations among major powers. Indeed, any durable and peaceful 21st century world order would much depend on how much we can deviate from the unhealthy zero-sum mindset of the 19th and 20th century, where our civil war always accompanied by new conflict and even war. We need to find a new path forward. I would call this agenda as assuring in the geopolitics of cooperation, where power, large, medium, and small interact on the basis of their commonalities rather than differences, viewing the world with a forward-looking mindset, leaving behind their zero-sum game in favor of win-win approach. Second, we must continue to evolve the architecture of cooperation that would nurture strategic trust among all the stakeholders. We are back to asking the same question that prevailing during the Cold War and after. How do we overcome the trust deficit? And how do we build or rebuild confidence? Certainly not an easy question. Strategic trust does not develop overnight. They grow from time-consuming effort, from countless meetings and talks, and from the experience of working together, which lead to mutual understanding. They involve in lengthy give and take process, and a constant demonstration of goodwill. Strategic trust grows from system confidence building measures and success in managing or resolving conflict. Once we achieve such strategic trust, we need to keep earning it, because trust can fade after a while. Third, we must never tire to develop confidence building and press on with our effort to resolve ongoing as well as potential conflict. I see 1 minute remaining. Okay. Well, it's very important forum actually, but I will follow the regulation. In closing, I believe that Asians today live in momentous time. I am positive that most Asians believe that their future will be better than the present. I share this optimism. I predict that Asia will continue to grow and prosper, and hopefully become more peaceful. But it is not a preordained destination. We need to work hard and stay the course to get there. We need to strengthen, expand, deepen, and innovate a better regional cooperation. We don't want to lose the momentum, because as has happened to other regions, a golden decade can turn into a lost decade in a moment. In short, we need to minimize risk, maximize opportunities, reduce tension in the supply, interdependence, improve trust, and spread opportunities. A tall order indeed, but it is today to rely. As your apology, actually there are another 2 minutes to complete my presentation, because I want just to say important thing that we have to work together in developing this region for a better future. I thank you.